This is CNN breaking news.
All right, President Trump is expected to withdraw from the Paris Climate Accord signed by 192 nations. Sources tell CNN a formal announcement will happen this week. What will it mean? Joining us now is CNN senior political commentator David Axelrod. The rationale has not been laid out for this move. The president has not addressed it with the American people, but apparently, the argument would be it's too expensive for the United States. It's not a good deal. We'll take care of our business at home and not spend money abroad. Your take?
Well, look, I think it's a fundamentally political decision on the part of an embattled president who couldn't brook a revolt among his base. And this was a key issue for his base. We know that there was a big debate raging in the White House between his economic advisors and his national security advisors, who were on one side, which is to stay in the agreement, and Steve Bannon, who represents his political side and really speaks for that fundamental populist base that elected him. And he opted to go with the base on this. I think there are terrible ramifications of it in terms of our relationships, not just with Europe, but also in Asia and other countries around the world. And clearly the business community was united in its hope that he would not withdraw from the Paris Agreement, but he made a decision to hang on to his core supporters here, who were absolutely resolute that he should pull out of the Paris Agreement.
Yeah, it is interesting to see who has the president's ear at any given time. So as you point out, David, it sounds as if Gary Cohn, one of his top advisors, Rex Tillerson, Ivanka Trump, that they were for staying in the Paris Accord. And then, as you say, Steve Bannon and, of course, Scott Pruitt of the EPA right. were against it. It's hard to know exactly where President Trump is in terms of climate change, because he's been a little bit all over the map. In 2005, he tweeted this: among the lowest temperatures ever in much of the United States, ice caps at record size. They changed the name from global warming to climate change. This is when he thought that it was more of a hoax. And then yesterday, Sean Spicer, press secretary, was asked about where are the president's views? What are they now on this? And here's what he said.
This morning, the president met with Environmental Protection Agency Administrator Pruitt. One of the topics that they discussed, of course, was the president's upcoming decision on the Paris Climate Accords.
Can you say whether or not the president believes that human activity is contributing to the warming of the climate?
Honestly, I haven't asked him.
Okay.
I'll get back to you.
And do you feel like that is a decision he's still trying to make?
I don't know. I honestly haven't asked him that specific question.
David, your thoughts?
Well, I mean, the one thing we know about his position on climate change is that it's changeable. And the political climate has changed such that he feels it's in his benefit to be against this, to pull out of Paris. You mentioned that it's hard to know who has his ear at any given time. It's interesting because, you remember not that many weeks back, there were all these stories about how Bannon was on his way out, that Bannon was in disrepute with the president. Well, clearly he is ascendant again in the White House, and this decision reflects that.
You know, hopefully for tomorrow we'll work up exactly what these accords were about, what they did and why, because this is another issue that's going to be burdened with a lot of mis and disinformation in explaining this move. So we'll try and get people some information so they understand what's happening. What is your take? We read your Twitter feed, but about midnight last night, the president letting his fingers do the walking and comes up with this. Despite the constant negative press called Fefe, Camerata decides to swallow the V on that as if it were French.
I think it's called Fefe.
Like that. Yeah, that's it. I mean, it sounds better.
Very nice.
In
very
any
nice.
Case, is this exhibit number 5,280 of why he should not be on Twitter?
Well, he asked what it meant. He joked that people can speculate on what it meant. I said that it is the sound of a sputtering machine running out of power. But what it says to me is there's something really amiss in the White House. Yes, I mean, the issue of whether he should taper off of Twitter has long since been decided by everybody but him. But how, you know, I make typos on Twitter, you probably do as well. You generally delete it after 10 seconds. How can the President of the United States tweet something nonsensical like that and have it sit there for 6 hours and no one in the White House, I know it was midnight, but people work around the clock at the White House. How does no one say, hey, you know, sir, we'd better delete this or delete it for him? And that, you know, that's a process issue. I thought that was insane that that they allowed that thing to hang around as long as it did. So there are all kinds of problems that that tweet put to that. I don't want to get into the sort of psychobabble about it, but just in terms of process, it really is an alarming thing.
And it's a reflection. It's symptomatic. Oh, how is it symptomatic? Because look what followed it. He then goes with Carter Page and tweets at a man he said he didn't even know. He starts defending him, owns his story, and implies in a tweet that Brennan and Comey were lying in their testimony.
Well, it also speaks to, Chris, how difficult the job is going to be for his lawyers, who must grimace every time they look at his Twitter account. So he better zip it up. That's the advice he's going to get from them.
It's a teachable moment for our children to check your work before hitting send.
Exactly.
Thank you very much for the bottom line, David.
All right, guys, have a great day.
You too.